name is Barbara K. McKisser Finley. I was born in Phoenix, Arizona. We moved quite a bit growing up. So I lived in Phoenix briefly, moved to New York City, moved to Southern California, went to 13 grade schools and 4 high schools, and ended up in Nevada shortly after that. So we moved to Nevada in October of 1962. I continued college there. At the time, it was still Nevada Southern University, but when I graduated, it was University of Nevada at Las Vegas. So that was in 71 when I graduated from there. I met my husband in Las Vegas, and we have 2 sons who are now almost 50 years old and almost 40. I don't know how that time went by like that. But while in Nevada, I finished school. I went to work as an accountant for a number of years. After doing some different jobs during school, I was also a dancer for a while. And then moved up to Reno, where I went to work for the Social Security Administration for almost 12 years. And during that time, I also went to law school, which I had begun earlier and had to quit to move back to Nevada with the job I had at the time. So I ended up completing law school at Old College, Nevada School of Law, which is no longer here, but graduated 5 classes of us. And after that, opened my own law office after clerking for District Court Judge Peter Breen, then had my own law office, and then ran for Justice of the Peace for Reno Township. I was elected to that position 2 terms, and I'm now a senior justice of the peace, where I can serve anywhere in the state in the limited jurisdiction courts, and I only do that occasionally. Otherwise, I'm in full retirement now. Well, I have to tell a story. When I was in the 8th grade in Phoenix, and we had taken all of those Scholastic Achievement tests and everything, and I had scored very well, and the teacher was talking about people becoming the first woman president of the United States and things like that. Another classmate wanted to do that. And the teacher made the remark that if anyone in the class could do that, he thought I would, which surprised everybody in the class. But my response was I really wasn't interested in being the first woman president. I would much rather be the first woman justice of the Supreme Court. And my mother was involved in some litigation at times while we were growing up, and I was fascinated with the law because it seemed to me that it's so pervasive. It affects everything you do, but most people aren't aware of it until it affects them, and usually negatively. So it was just something I always thought was very basic and very important. So when I went to school, I graduated with a degree in political science, but I then started law school at McGeorge. And left there and came back to Nevada and wanted to get back to law school, but I knew if I did, I was not going to be working 6 days a week and going to law school at night when I did. So when they opened Nevada School of Law at Old College, I had an opportunity to cut back at work to part-time and decided I was going to go for it. So I thought we had a wonderful education there. We had some great teachers, and the other students, it was such an interesting experience because most of them were already involved in other careers. So they brought the life experience with them as well as just, you know, the schooling and academic background. So it really contributed a lot to the discussions in the class because they'd already experienced some of these things. So I found that to be very valuable, and I just believe in having goals. And so once I was an attorney, because I did still want to be a judge, and when I clerked for Judge Breen, I really looked at that as, is this a job I would want to do, really, or is it just the idea of it? But I found it to be very compatible with my temperament and how I looked at things, and I had a strong sense of justice that I thought would fit very well with Justice Court. Well, Justice Court is, to me, the most interesting court we have. It's the one most people first encounter the judicial system, whether it's for citations, traffic, and other citations that they handle there. All the landlord-tenant matters, evictions, are done in Justice Court. have small claims court, which includes matters not exceeding $5,000. I think that has gone up since then. The monetary jurisdiction for justice court overall is $10,000. So you have civil matters that don't exceed $10,000. They're brought in justice court. We also do criminal matters. We do all the misdemeanors. Well, not all of them. Municipal court does some too in the city. But for the county and outlying jurisdictions, justice court handles misdemeanors, which includes DUIs, driving under the influence, domestic violence, other petty larceny kinds of things. We also do the preliminary hearings for felonies, which include murder and other, you know, very serious crimes. So the diversity that exists there, to me, is something that I really enjoy, because you never have the same kind of thing twice. But you also don't get kind of bogged down as you can in district court, or certainly in the Supreme Court has a longer view of things and takes much longer to resolve situations. Justice court is a pretty high volume, rapid pace court. And we had a very fine group of judges who got along, would fill in for one another, and really made it work very well, I think. So I enjoyed it tremendously. And we had a very good, you know, functioning court. It's, you know, something that most people aren't going to be happy being there. So you try and make them at ease if it's that kind of case. But at the same time, it's serious. So it's a very educational experience for most of the people appearing in front of you. There's a lot of debt collection and things of lender, debtor, owing money kinds of things that come to justice court. And you do need to know the law, but a lot of it is you're dealing with real people and not just lawyers. I guess I'm most proud of finally getting to some of my goals, even though it's taken me a lot longer than some people. I didn't become an attorney until I was in my 40s. So by the time I became a judge, I feel my life experience was as valuable as the legal training I'd had for that position. I also believe in helping other people attain their goals. I had several interns working with me when I was in the court, from high school, mainly advanced placement classes that would send them once a week to work a few hours and get to learn about the court. And I enjoy that. I don't know that I taught them a lot, but I think just exposing them to the situations and the job process there, to give them an opportunity to learn as much as they could while they were there, it is so helpful in trying to determine what a person wants to do in their life. A lot of us just kind of bounce around and happen to fall into one thing or another, but don't necessarily have the focus or the passion to really make those determinations when we're young. So I think the more experience you can get in different areas and to see what really you enjoy doing, what kind of job fits your temperament and your situation, I think all of that's helpful. Well, one of my more interesting cases was a preliminary hearing for a very well-publicized case, because it involved Kathy Augustine, who was the statewide controller running for treasurer. And the preliminary hearing was with her husband, Chaz Higgs, who was later convicted in district court of her murder. And we had national coverage on that, which I still hear about, because people all over the country see it either on 48 Hours or Dateline or something, and they recognize me. Although they don't have me saying anything in there, but they have one shot of me. So I guess that's my lasting contribution to fame for that sort of thing. One of the things that I find so fascinating is the cultural changes that have happened for women during the time since I first came in the workforce. And I lived in Las Vegas for 10 years before I moved up to Reno. And the attitudes about women, and when you see the television shows like Mad Men, that was all very true in a sense that just the, I don't know, I don't know how the term goes, and it wasn't really that it was sexist so much, but it was. But you learned to handle it, and you learned to handle it with grace. Once the women's liberation movement took hold, I think some women had a harder time handling that gracefully, and they did more of a butting heads kind of thing, which isn't necessarily as effective, but it gets the job done too. So I think just the cultural changes for women in the workplace that have taken place since I've been in this arena have really fascinated me and continue to do so. There's still some, ways to go before things are fully where they should be. But I think we've made a lot of gains. Remember what you're looking for, what you want out of life, and make sure that you try and keep it so when you make mistakes, they're not going to be really detrimental ones that are going to affect you for years. You want to keep in a positive direction with your life and remember what your goals are. My friend Kathy Nonneman, we met the first day of law school and decided to start our law practice after I had clerked for Judge Breen for a year. And during that time, really watching different attorneys, getting to know the legal community in Reno, and also figuring out what kinds of law I didn't want to practice. So we started discussing the idea of opening our own law practice. And somebody asked me what kind of law we were going to practice. And I just off the cuff said, I think we're going to have a little boutique law firm. We're going to practice very civil law and serve tea every Thursday at 4. And then the more I thought about it, the more sense it made. As somebody with a new business, to be able to invite people for tea. We didn't do free consultations and that kind of practice. So if somebody wanted to bring somebody to the law practice or to the law office, but they don't want to pay for a consultation with somebody they don't even know, bring them to tea. Let them get to know us first. And so we didn't discuss cases during that time. We just had people come by and we served tea. I ended up with quite a collection of teacups and a nice silver tea service. But it was just one of the rules that once a week from 4 o'clock to 5 on Thursdays, we would have tea. And it ended up being something that just kind of added a little civility to the practice. So we did a lot of estate planning, wills and trusts and probate. We did some family law. But we did the kind of law that we wanted to make sure we knew more about and that we knew people who were interested in those issues. So that was the start of that tradition. Do I think gender makes a difference in being a judge or a lawyer? I think it makes a difference in so much as your personality and temperament for anybody makes a difference. But I think it's really important to have certain characteristics as a judge. And I tend to think women sometimes, and of course this is a generality too, but women are better at some of those characteristics of having an even temperament and not going off the handle, not being so ego invested in your position that you don't really listen to the other people. I think women are good listeners on the whole. And I think maybe better than men sometimes, but there are a lot of men who are wonderful judges and attorneys too. So it's one of those generalities that you can't make a blanket statement, but I think women contribute a great deal to the judiciary in this state. And the women who have become judges and at every level, I think have added to the perception of justice in the state. I think it can be difficult sometimes when you're dealing with men who still have that attitude that women shouldn't be in this profession. And some women even have that attitude. But I think we're getting past that. And I think it's recognized that there are a large number of really great women judges. I find that it's been a very fulfilling life. I love being a woman in Nevada. It's been an opportunity to know your political leaders like no other state. And I feel privileged to be part of a community, because growing up as I did and moving around a lot, you never really felt you were part of it. And in Reno especially, and Nevada as a whole, I do feel that way. So my advice to young women growing up at this point would be to try and keep focus. Don't go too far afield, but also never give up. You can get off track a few times and still find your way back and figure out what you want to do with your life and how you're going to get there. And if you have a few setbacks, that's okay too. As someone who mentioned to me that I was going to be 40-something when I finished law school, and I said, well, hopefully I'm going to be 40-something anyway, so I'd just as soon have a law degree when I get there.